You say in here to Dr. Danforth that you have a great deal of remorse and regret over the death of your son, and you miss him and think of him every day. Well, Ms. Hoskins, your conduct belies that. Your conduct shows me that's not true. I reviewed the jail tapes, the phone calls. There's no coercion here. You're out. Mr. Hoskins is in. All right? He's got no power over you. You're participating. You're talking to him on these phone tapes like nothing had happened within days of your knowing that this man had killed your son. There's no remorse here. There's none. I'm not certain whether you are even capable of emotion. I don't know. I don't know how you could hold it together, talk to this man on the phone like you did in these circumstances, and have any emotion whatsoever. So these offenses are clearly more serious than less serious. Recidivism is not only likely, in my view, it is a certainty in the event that you are released or when you are released. If I accept the defense portrayal and Dr. Ganshert's portrayal of you, then you will commit another crime if you are released. You have a history of a conviction, as I outlined earlier, on a federal charge. You've served time in penitentiary. You've not responded previously to sanctions that courts have imposed, and that includes a prison sentence, a halfway house, reporting probation while on felony probation to the federal authorities. And so that recidivism, I think, is extremely likely. There certainly is no genuine remorse here, and I don't know that you have any remorse at all, genuine or otherwise. You express remorse, but I don't see that there is any. I take that from your conduct at the funeral, the diaries, the continued contact with the person who actually caused the death, the manner and form of the contact that you had with that person. All of that's inconsistent with your having any feeling of remorse in this particular case. These are, based upon all the circumstances here, the worst form of these offenses I think that I've seen.